All right, I want to go over some of my initial impressions on this new trailer, talk about what I think the new Pokemon are going to be like, and sort of my first impressions on, do I like them? Do I like the direction the series is headed? Stuff like that. And then point out a few things that maybe you've missed in the trailer. Sure, other people will do that, and you'll eventually catch up on all of it, but this is just my impressions. I've got a series of screenshots from the video itself. I don't want to get copyright flagged for showing the entire video. The first screenshot here, I thought it was noteworthy that we've got Drifloon and Applin and Hatena off to the side. Drifloon was already confirmed to be in the game, and I don't know about Applin, but Hatena is not shown anywhere else in the trailer as far as I know. And if we are just to assume that because Drifloon is shown here and Drifloon is in the game, then I would assume the Hatterene will also be in the game, and so will the Apples, which will be good because I like all those. Okay, besides that, we just got the backpack here. This is looking to be Scarlet version. It is what it is. All right. Here we get our first look at the new Pokemon Centers, and I think this is a pretty good change for this series. Instead of having to go into a building and go out of a building, I can just walk up to get healed, which is really nice. Of course, you might say, well, why can't I just heal from anywhere? But then, of course, one of the only challenges Pokemon has is that they give you a long route with lots of trainers and wild Pokemon you have to beat, allowing you to heal at any given point would negate any semblance of a challenge, even if you can still, you know, access a box from anywhere and have a whole party of 100 Pokemon to get you through any particular section. Now, we'll talk more about this in a second. This isn't a very good angle. I have a later picture that I want to talk about it in more detail at that point. All right, this picture here shows the rival, and it seems to imply that you're going to get all three starters, but I strongly doubt that. Instead, I assume this is sort of like the opening to Legends Arceus, where you wash up on shore. Obviously, you're not washed up on shore here, but all three of the starter Pokemon are interacting with you. Your rival walks up, and it's like, oh, well, I see you and three Pokemon. These must be all your Pokemon. But no, you're just going to get the one, probably. Maybe I'm wrong on that point. She looks fine. Her glove looks interesting. I like that. Alright, this is our new Pika clone for the region. We'll talk more about it when I pull up the Scarlet and Violet official website. But initial impressions, it's okay. One thing I did want to note on this page is that in the background we can see there's an ad for tires, it looks like. And we got Quillfish on that. I guess the Quillfish is supposed to be popping the tire or something. Now, of course, an ad isn't necessarily a confirmation that a Pokemon will be in the region, but I do think it's interesting that it's Quillfish, specifically because we had the Hisuian Quillfish that came out recently, and if Pokemon wants to bring those Hisuian forms into the main games, I think it would be a good possibility that Quillfish will be in the game. Maybe it's already been shown and I missed it in the first trailer. Okay, this move I think is Thunder Wave. Not too surprising that the electric type knows Thunder Wave, or maybe it's Nuzzle. We didn't get to see it actually hit the opponent, so I don't know, but it sounded like Thunder Wave to me. Alright, this here is showing off the four-player multiplayer feature. One thing I noted here is that ostensibly this is at the beginning of the game, and already we can see that we have some variation in outfits, which I think is a very good thing. I like customization in these games, and this could have been just for the continuation of the story of the trailer, where, you know, the one kid is going to go off to the ice region, so he's already got his beanie on. We don't want to start him off with something he's not wearing on later in the trailer. Maybe that's what they were going for. Maybe you won't have access to all these options that early in the game. I don't know. Also think it's funny that in this particular trailer, Quaxly is the only Pokemon that's not looking at the rest of the group. He's looking at his trainer, or maybe, you know, 100 yards into the distance, not really sure exactly where he's looking off to. All right, this here we can see, okay, the Pokemon are following us. How long will they follow us? I don't know. But I did want to point out that the Pokemon are following at some distance. Now, that may have been artistic and not representative of the final product, seeing as how maybe the Pokemon were like, oh, I didn't realize we were going now. And that's more for the trailer's benefit and less how it'll actually play out. But one of my major problems that I've had in the previous games where they allow follower Pokemon, specifically Sword and Shield and BDSP, is that the Pokemon follow really slowly. Not only do they have a really bad startup time for how quickly they're going to follow you after you start moving, but also a lot of the Pokemon go really slowly. And while that might be cute for Torterra, it's ridiculous when you've got Garchomp moving super slowly and he's got crazy base speed and can move at Mach 5 or whatever the heck he's supposed to be able to go. And why is he moving so slowly? That's just annoying and means that I'm not going to use that feature. So hopefully the following mechanics got fixed in this game, but it's not off to a good start. That's all I'm saying. Alright, we've got Fletchling here. This is interesting just because this trailer oftentimes, in previous generations, we've seen the Route 1 Pokemon. Usually there's some kind of Route 1 bird, and here we're seeing that we got the Fletchling line. And that makes sense to some extent because we are in Spain, which is right next door to France, which is Kalos, which is where Fletchling comes from. So I'm not too surprised to see Fletchling here, but I am a little bit surprised because we have not had a region where we didn't have some kind of regional bird. However, I don't necessarily think this disqualifies us from getting a regional bird in this new region, because it could be that we'll have more of a knockdown situation where in Johto we already had Pidgeot and Pidgeot still existed, but in addition to that we got knockdown, and that's a possibility that we'll see something like that later down the road. Okay, we see Flaffy here. I don't think we're going to get Mega Evolution back, but hey, maybe we will. Who knows? This is the new Olive Pokemon. I think it's pretty cute. The main thing I wanted to take away from this particular image is that we've got sneaking mechanics. Now, this isn't Legends Arceus, where we have real-time capture system. And so you say, well, what purpose does the sneaking mechanics have? As opposed to something like Oras, where you have the sneaking mechanics to get the Pokemon that were rustling the bushes or making dust clouds in the caves. Here, clearly all Pokemon are on the field and ready to be captured at any given point in time, and all I gotta do is run into one of them to start an encounter. So why would I need to sneak up on them? And I have at least one thought on that, is that this Olive Pokemon seems to be pretty shy and timid, and it may be that many more of these Pokemon get a free runaway at the beginning of a battle, sort of like within Legends Arceus. If that's the case, then this Pokemon might be pretty annoying to try to catch if you don't startle it from behind and get a free hit off on it. So we'll have to watch out for that. It may also be that they're just sneaking because they wanted to have the sneaking mechanics like they did in Sword and Shield, and they were just doing it for the trailer to make it look like there's actually something going on, but it may not actually mean anything. In the background, we have our obligatory tree textures. I will say it's nice to see multiple kinds of trees in close proximity, but that's about all I'll say on that point, because that's beating a dead horse. Alright, this here is another interesting one. We got the new pig Pokemon. This pig Pokemon sort of waddles up to the trainer. I don't think it already belongs to the trainer. I think it's a wild one. So either this is its attacking animation, which is pretty slow and unimpressive, or it's possible that this is a cutscene and that this is the first Pokemon that you'll fight and that this is a scripted event. I think that's somewhat likely because this was shown to be level 2 and that would be a pretty good starter Pokemon to fight. That's just my theory though. Speaking of, here's that level 2 encounter. with Lechonk, and pretty adorable Pokemon. I have no issues with this Pokemon. Maybe when it evolves, I will. But for right now, it's pretty cute. And I think that it, it'll probably be a normal ground type, but I should save that for later on in the video. We get to see the UI here, and that's the reason why I saved this particular image. I like how the UI looks. I think it looks really sleek, really clean, really easy to see what's going on. Not really sure what's going on with the corner edges on the top left and the bottom right, but sure, whatever. Maybe it's like we're looking through a camera or something, I don't know. You already have two Pokemon by this point, so maybe that sort of throws my initial encounter theory out the window, but what do I know? We've got the check status screen right in the bottom. I think that's sort of a nice change. Maybe it sort of gets in the way of the image, but I did feel like the Sword and Shield with the check status sort of got lost and people forgot it was there. Having it more front and center is nice. Hopefully they give us a good status screen that we can see lots of things on. I like the icons for battle and Pokemon and bag. I think those are really well done. Alright, here we can see some Flabebes in the grass. They're very nice and small. I do like to see that they have some sense of scale for the Pokemon in this world, because I think that's pretty important to give the Pokemon more individual personality. And then we've got this, I don't know if that's a youngster or if that's a priest. No, it's not a preschooler. Some class, a trainer. Got a little Toro shirt. Once again, don't think that necessarily indicates the Toro should be in the region. Just because it's on your shirt doesn't mean it has to be in the region. I think we saw that at least a few times in Alola and other places. So I'm not banking on Tauros being here, but thought I'd point it out. Choodle is in the game. I'm pretty pleased with that. I think Dreadnoughts were pretty fun. Some Rain Sweeper, especially in a limited metagame. So I'm glad to see it back. Here's that better picture of the Pokemart, and we can see that the red is the heel and the blue appears to have an item bag there, and that seems to have been the color scheme that Pokemon Company has been using, or Game Freak has been using, for the past few generations. That's not too surprising. The green one is a bit more of an enigma. I couldn't figure out what the green stood for, so I have to come up with a theory, and I have two possible options. One, it's for money of some sort, or maybe it's for tasks, sort of like they had in Sword and Shield. That's a strong possibility now that I think about it. I'm not really a big fan of those tasks. I think it was a waste of a mechanic. I never used it. I know people used it in the beginning when the timer, the clock system was broken in Sword and Shield and you could abuse it. But once people fixed it, it didn't do anything. I liked the Pokepelago better than I did the Gen 8 missions. Gen 8 missions were just not fun. One thing that I think would be fun if that green kiosk is for the daycare, and that you could access the daycare at any point in your journey, that would allow you to quickly get eggs or to pick up a Pokemon that maybe you've been letting sit there and level, if that's an option in this particular version. And that could be really fun, because then you could find a spot to run around on your bicycle or whatever and hatch your eggs, and you could pick wherever you wanted it to be and not just have it in one particular spot. That's what I want it to be. I'm not saying that's what it will be, but I think that'd be pretty cool. Here, I believe this is just straight up in the overworld, literally where we left those two trainers from the previous picture. And they're doing an in-world trade, which I think is pretty nifty. If that helps with immersion, I think that'll be good. But I also am pretty sure this is only going to be an option for the four trainers that you're currently linked up with. So if you have you and your siblings, or maybe some of you and your close friends all playing at the same time, that's cool. Then you can trade in the overworld. But I can imagine that for the majority of players, you're not going to be playing with this four-player multiplayer, and you won't be able to avail yourself of this that often. You'll have to have some more kind of GTS system, or maybe you're going to use the GTS in Pokemon Home. Not really sure. But I don't know how often we're going to be able to see this particular option for trading. Here's Venonat. Venonat's cute, bouncing around. Looks like it has a decent amount of personality. One thing I thought that was interesting here, and we can't see it because it's not a video, but the Venonat is running at basically the same speed and trajectory as the player. I don't know if that means that it's a follower and that the trainer's already caught this particular Venonat, or if they just lined it up for the trailer such that the wild Pokemon is running alongside the trainer. But the Venonat was running at the same speed as the trainer, so I have to wonder that if in this game there's going to be more Pokemon that can actually catch you when you're running away besides Sharpedo, which I don't know how I feel about. Obviously, once you have beaten the game and you're just running around, you don't necessarily want to get interrupted by wild Pokemon, but it is nice to have Pokemon that are more of a threat to you in the wild, and so having them be able to run fast into you is pretty important for that. Here we see Colossal. Colossal's okay. Not much else to say except for the fact that they are wild Colossal, so I don't know if that means that this is a late game, like level 60 kind of encounter, or if this is a static encounter. I'm not exactly sure. Similarly, here we see Toxapex in the wild, and so because this is an open world game, it's possible that it takes a while to get to this particular point in the region, but these straight up got wild Toxapex, so that's pretty interesting. We also got Shellder in the background. Now most people are going to bemoan the return of Toxapex, but hey, the return of Toxapex alongside the return of Cloyster, maybe a useful Pokemon to have when you're trying to check Cheesy Shell Smash Sweep. Here we got Cryogonal. Cryogonal is pretty cool. Nice support Pokemon. One thing I wanted to point out is that the trainer in this region looks like he's trying to push against the wind. So I'm wondering if this particular snowy region will be like super windy and annoying to go through. That could be sort of obnoxious. I don't know if that means they're trying to block off the trainer from getting to the top of a mountain. And so they're sort of doing a Majora's Mask where the wind blows super hard so you can't get to a point without maybe the aid of a legendary Pokemon or something else to ride on that is strong enough to get through the wind, or if that's just always going to be here. I hope it's not always going to be there. Maybe it's just a weather pattern that can exist in the region. But I do know that running through Sinnoh, running through the snowy parts in Sinnoh was really annoying because you'd always get stuck in the snow, and it made me never want to go up there. And if this region or this part of the region is going to have a similar vibe where, oh look, there's a blizzard all the time and you're always constantly fighting the wind, that's not fun. They did that in Kalos in the desert, didn't like it there. Here is an arena of sorts. The only thing I wanted to point out is that in the top right, you've got that Sunflora. And I don't know if it's an actual Sunflora or if it's just a Sunflora lookalike in a pot, but you know, whatever that means to you, Sunflora maybe is in the game. All right, and now we've got our legendaries. Legendaries are all right, very over-designed, but that seems to be par for the course nowadays with our legendaries. And I'll talk more about them in a second when we get to the website itself. But one thing to note when we're looking at them here is that the one on the left looks like a motorcycle or some kind of hot rod. I'm not exactly sure. Not a car person, not a bike person, but it looks like a motorcycle. And the one on the right looks like some kind of jet propulsion super bike or hover craft. And I'm not going to get too much into that because that goes beyond just normal spoilers into unrevealed spoilers, but just keep that in the back of your head. On that note, let's go to the next and last slide. Or no, actually not the last. Here we can see sort of close-ups similar to Seviper, this gives off pretty good vibes. You've got the high textures, or at least high for Pokemon textures, and that looks nice. Hopefully this translates into the actual games, but with Sword and Shield we saw really nice looking trailers for Zacian and Zamazenta. Didn't necessarily translate into the main game, so I wouldn't expect the models to look this nice in game, unfortunately. I do think it's a little bit weird that we've got like LED eyes. It's like a high-tech Pokemon. With previous Pokemon that were based off technology, a lot of them were man-made, like Porygon. But it seems weird that you've got straight up like a Pokemon that looks like it was made by humans, but clearly is like a force of nature. So that's sort of funky. Not sure I feel about that. These Pokemon, though, we'll talk more about them in a bit here, and they're going to be pretty important to understanding how this game is going to go. This final slide, I don't know what this means. Is this just a splash image for Pokemon that they wanted to put at the end of all of their videos? I don't think it is, because I couldn't find it anywhere else, but if it is, then you can let me know. But it looks sort of like crystals or ice crystals. I'm not sure if it's ice or if it's quartz or diamond or something in the background. And they're sort of forming and reforming upon themselves as a Pokemon whooshes out. What does this mean? I have absolutely no clue. But that is what it is. Let's go over to the website now. Okay. Here we are on the official website. And we've got lots of information on the official website that we still have to cover. So one of the first things I want to talk about is this sentence here. It says that it's a world that you're free to explore at your leisure and not in an order dictated by the story. And I think this really confirms that they're committed to making this an actual open world game and not open world like they were pretending in Sword and Shield. Or even maybe like Legends Arceus. I don't know exactly if this will have regions with loading screens, or if it'll be one seamless and fluid experience. I hope it will be that, sort of like Breath of the Wild, or any other real open world game, but that remains to be seen. However, at the very least, I can go anywhere in the region and not have to worry about the story. I think this is fantastic. Every time I play a Pokemon game, I want to be able to go in and have a Pokemon, a team of six Pokemon, and then my Pokemon on this particular playthrough. And a lot of Pokemon in regions sort of get gatekeeped to the end game. And so there's never really options unless you're going to bring in eggs or trade them from a friend or something. And I don't really like that. So it's much nicer to be able to say, hey, I know where this Pokemon is supposed to be for this playthrough. I'm going to go run off in that direction and get that. Similar to Breath of the Wild, it also sort of means that if you played through on your first time blind, it could be really cool, because maybe they'll point you in a certain direction using game design, sort of like they did with the Zora domain in the first game, in Breath of the Wild. But in this game, maybe they'll do a similar thing, but you don't have to go that way. And it could be that you will find different Pokemon and have a different kind of game experience compared to your friends, and just based on the fact that it's an open world game. I think that's really exciting. I do like that as an idea. I also think it fits better into the way that the world needs to be built. It always bugged me that in Black and White that you had low-level Pokemon in one part of the region and high-level Pokemon in another part. Then you come to Black and White 2, and a lot of those places have been completely turned on their head, and you have the similar kind of thing going on in Johto versus Kanto. When you get to Gen 2 versus Gen 1, although not quite to that same extent. And so I like the idea that Pokemon just exist everywhere in this world, and you can run into them at any level at any given time. I do wonder, the more badges you get, are Pokemon going to scale up? So those talk specs we saw earlier, they're going to be Marini if you go there super early, and maybe they won't even be available if you go there super early. That could be something, in which case, maybe even though it's open world, you won't have access to all the Pokemon early in the game. Not exactly sure. I hope you do. We'll see though. Okay, we see Talonflame here, that's cool. And yeah, we talked about most of that. So let's get on to talking about the Pokemon themselves. Let's go down here. Alright, the first thing I want to talk about is Crydon and Mudraidon. Now, when I looked at this initially, the first thing I said, oh, Mudraidon. I recognize Mirai. That's the Japanese word for future. And that's sort of low-hanging fruit. So fortunately, I understood that this, you know, Don is sort of a dragon or a dinosaur term, and Mirai means future. So this is in line with its jet boosters. It's a very futuristic looking design, and that's basically what it's based off of. Korai, though, I don't know what that means, but I figured it would be the opposite. And going off of this subreddit, it appears that that is what they're going for there. This person here says that Korai means Japanese for ancient, and Mirai is Japanese for future. So that's good to know. Similarly, with the professor names, we get Futuro and Pasada. I don't speak Spanish, but Turo and Sada mean, are part of Futuro and Pasada. And so you get future and past. So clearly, in this game, past and future are going to be pretty important elements. So we'll have to wait and see how they actually play out. But at the very least, we can anticipate that being a theme. Okay, let's talk about these Pokemon. So the first one, we got Pawmi. Pawmi, like I said before, is our Pika clone. And it's supposed to be like based off an orange or something. I'm not exactly sure. It's alright. It's pretty cute. And the one thing I noted from this stat sheet is that it has static. Sure, that's fine. A lot of them do. In fact, I think 90% of them do. I think more Pico doesn't. But I think all the other ones do. And then it has Natural Cure. Natural Cure is a pretty fun ability. It's useful when it's useful. And it's not useful when it's not useful. But hey, if you get frozen, if you get burned, you don't care. You switch out. It's not going to make this Pokemon broken. But it does give it some use in battle. That's all I really have to say on that Pokemon. Now we got Lechonk. People are pretty hyped about Lechonk. They think that's a really hilarious name. I think it's pretty funny myself. But what I'm more excited about is getting back to its abilities again. We see it has Gluttony. Aroma Veil is okay. But Gluttony, I think, is going to be a fantastic ability for this Pokemon. It's possible that this Pokemon has Recycle. If it has Recycle, it can run a similar set to Snorlax. It could also have Slack Off, in which case you might be able to stay healthy and still get into a Gluttony range. And I think the main use for Gluttony will be to run something like maybe a Salac Berry, depending on how its evolution ends up speed tier wise. Maybe it's base 40 speed, in which case Gluttony wouldn't be the greatest. Maybe it'll be a base 60 speed, in which case Gluttony could actually be decent with Salac. And if we look at its typing, it's normal for now, but it's the Route 1 Pokemon. I'm not too surprised by that. It could be a normal ground, sort of like Diggersby, which would be a little bit funny to have Diggersby in Kalos and then Lechonk's evolution in Spain, and they're both normal ground. But it is sort of like a pig that's going to be rooting around in the ground, and it looks like it's got a muddy face, so I would not at all be surprised to see this be another normal ground type. In which case, you know, bulky ground type, it's got Gluttony, that definitely could come into play. And then none of this really matters except for the fact that it's got an aroma that bug Pokemon dislike. I don't think that's going to have any mechanical properties other than the Aroma Veil, which is where that comes from. But, you know, that's fine. Smoliv is the Pokemon that I think is the funniest looking. One of the reasons I think it's so funny is to look at it, say, oh look, I could draw this Pokemon. This is the easiest Pokemon ever to draw. And then you look at these you know, legendaries, look at how over-designed they are. Very, very big difference between the two. This has barely got any lines at all on it. Anyway, grass normal type. Grass normal type, not great. Depending on the coverage it gets, it could be better. But we saw with the Deerling line that doesn't really do too much for you. However, one thing to note is that it has the ability Early Bird, which is a complete trash ability, and it's the only ability that's listed here. So I'm anticipating that its evolution will get a signature ability. I believe, don't quote me on this, but I believe that there were at least one or two Pokemon that were revealed in Sword and Shield that had similarly barren abilities, and then once their evolutions were revealed with their signature abilities, then they reversed and filled in their pre-evos as well. So I'm hoping this means that we get a signature ability for Smoliv's evolution. This could be a one-stage evolution. I'm hoping it's two, sort of like Bounsweet. In fact, this reminds me a lot of Bounsweet. A little bit like Puddle too. And I'm hoping it also loses its normal type. Normal type doesn't really do anything for grass types, because the only thing that it helps to really hit, I guess, would be, what, fire types for neutral. but that doesn't really get you anything. Grass types already struggle with steel types. Normal types not helping you with that, and vice versa. And cool, I guess I'm immune to ghost types, for whatever that's worth. Not much. So, Smoliv has potential. I do like his design. I think it's pretty adorable. But we shall see how it actually ends up. And I think that's probably it. Maybe I will do another video in the future talking about some other things if I get some more ideas. But for right now, I think that's about it. Here are two professors we already talked about their names before. I don't really have anything to say about their designs. It's pretty clear he's got a futuristic design. She's got like a cave person design. Well, that's fine. I don't really care too much about that. So I will wrap it up for today. So I'll see you next time.